Hi everyone, it's Nancy Guppy coming to you from my Queen Anne Hill condominium, and this is Art Zone Phones It In special interview with Mayor Durkan edition. A few days ago, I was lucky enough to get on Mayor Durkan's very busy schedule to chat online with her about Seattle arts in a time of coronavirus, the art of leadership, and her favorite comfort food.
Well, Mayor Durkan, welcome to my living room.
Welcome to my study.
Oh, it's a lovely study, and thank you so much for your time. I really, really appreciate it.
No, it's great to be here, and it's kind of a bucket list of mine to be able to sit down and talk to you. So I'm sorry it happened this way, but this is awesome.
Oh man, it's fantastic! I love that. So I recently interviewed Randy Engstrom, director of Seattle's Office of Arts and Culture, and we talked about your $1.1 million arts recovery package for artists and creative workers impacted by COVID-19. So first off, I want to thank you for that. That is a huge support and a huge statement.
Yeah, we wish we could do more. And I can't say enough about Randy. He has just been, you know, since I've become mayor, such a trusted advisor, but his connection with community, he feels the arts and culture in his bones.
Yeah.
And it's what makes Seattle, Seattle. If we lose our joy and our creativity, then we lose our soul. And so trying to find ways to reignite and nurture that through this really difficult time is a real priority for me, for him, for the city. So thank you for your work and really highlighting that.
Oh yeah, it's such an honor to get to focus on the arts and the cultural life of Seattle. And I want to know, I understand this, but can you tell us why you see the arts as a civic and economic priority?
So it is both. First, if you look through the history of the human species, those great cities and those great civilizations always had a vibrant artistic part of them. It sounds trite, but I do think it's the way we kind of capture our common soul and common humanity. And it's the way we express everything from despair to joy, how we come together. And it's both the art itself, which is an expression of who we are, but the very act of coming together to experience that is part of who we are. And I think that's one of the things that's been really hard about the last 6 weeks is we've had to sever those ties that make us the most human, that are really our ties to our common humanity. Mm-hmm. And so finding ways to make sure that not just when we come out of this, we have a vibrant art and culture, but through this, we find more ways for people to express and connect in that way is really important.
Yeah. And so clearly, the top priority right now is to continue what we're doing to contain the virus, obviously. But looking ahead, and I think it's really important to look ahead, when we start to take steps to Seattle reopening, what do you think that might look like for the arts community, museums, galleries, theaters?
You know, I think we're going to start having those conversations for them because I think they're the first to say, here's what we do and here's how we think we can do it differently. Mm-hmm. So we're already having conversations and figuring out how do we go sector by sector, including in the arts. We've got to start innovating now while we're still in the stay home, stay healthy. How do we get a more online presence to get some of our established artists and evolving artists to do something that everyone could tune into at the same time or mm-hmm. take a tour of? Mm-hmm. And so we want to make sure that now that we've gotten through the first steps of the crisis, how do we start building that social connectivity in ways that aren't Zoom meetings where everybody's saying, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Right. You're kind of breaking up, right?
You're breaking up.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about the art of leadership. I've been wanting to talk to you about this. Clearly, in this time of COVID-19, leadership has never been more important. How would you describe artful leadership?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I think it can vary, but I think the first step of any good leader and the art of leadership is you have to be willing to listen. Mm. And you have to get people who know more than you know on anything you're asking about and assimilate that. And then the second thing you have to be able to do is make a decision. And there is no leader that is going to make 100% the right decisions as we move through this. And I talk to mayors, not just around the country, but I've been connected now with a bunch of global mayors to hear what people are doing, what's working, what's not working, how communities respond to different restrictions and how you might ease that, how important it is to communicate really transparently. So I think you got to listen, you have to decide, but you also have to communicate, because I think particularly here in Seattle, people will take action if they understand why they're doing it and what positive impact it can have. Mm-hmm. So I think the art of leadership has to be, you got to listen, you got to decide, you got to communicate well, and you have to be willing to change course if it's not working.
Bingo. That's a humbleness, right?
Yeah.
That's a healthy ego. That's a humbleness. Are there leaders that you look to, past or present, for inspiration, for hope?
I call my friends across the country a lot who are mayors of other cities in particular, sometimes at other levels, just to say, what are you seeing? What are you doing? I talk to friends who were in the Obama administration. Hmm. But for me, in many ways, this is going to sound kind of corny and trite. The individual acts of courage and kindness have been really my inspiration through this. What we're doing is so hard, and it has been so devastating to so many people, but yet to see people rise through that and do things that are, you know, on an individual level so courageous, it makes me feel, as an elected leader, I have an obligation to honor that kind of courage and sacrifice.
That brings tears to my eyes. Has the experience of dealing with COVID-19 changed you as a leader, do you think?
No question about it. Both how I make decisions and how we govern. You know, we're doing more and more remotely, and we're doing it at a pace that government was never built for before. So the old ways of deciding don't hold up in a crisis. And so you have to do things at a pace, particularly to help people. So, you know, standing up programs and just deciding we're going to stop residential evictions and evictions of nonprofits and small businesses. Mm-hmm. We're going to convert money and give it for grocery vouchers or loans to small businesses, trying to build that resiliency in as quickly as possible, which under previous Seattle process could have taken months, if not years.
Oh yeah.
You know, and it doesn't mean you don't want input, but you just have to change. And then I think there is I think everybody has changed in how this has affected them personally, for themselves, for their families, for their loved ones. All of us know somebody who's gotten sick. We worried about all of our family members that they might get sick. And so the real life impacts of every decision could be overwhelming if you let them be, because they're such a scale, such a scope, that you can't really be prepared for them. You just have to move through them, make the best decisions you can, and keep listening.
So that segues perfectly to my next question for you. As mayor, you have to exude a calm and steady presence, which you do, which we all appreciate. But of course, there's the non-mayor side of Jenny Durkan. So I'm wondering how you are dealing with this emotionally and mentally, kind of more on that. I don't mean that you're not a human. I mean, you know what I mean? As a mayor, of course, you're a human, but kind of more in that kind of personal way.
You know, I would say it's really hard, and working from home has its own positives, but, you know, particularly in the first weeks, it was 15, 18 hour days. Oh. And it was, every decision had such grave implications for it. Mm-hmm. And so to try to both digest that personally, but also see the impacts of the team around me, I have the best team anywhere. I could not be doing any of the things I've been doing without the team, both in the mayor's office, but across the city. The way that people have shown up in this crisis is amazing. The people of Seattle should be so proud. And so it's, you feel, you know, everyone's going through the cycle. Some days it's like, you know, we feel like we're cycling through those seven stages of grief every hour.
Constantly.
Constantly. And sometimes you get stuck on one or the other, sadness or anger. And then you have to be home where you're also navigating, you know, my youngest son is home from college because they moved to online. Mm-hmm. And, you know, my partner's here, and you also want to make sure that you're both worried about the disease itself, but how do you kind of navigate that sense of stress and not just increase it for everybody?
Right. Are there any go-to TV shows or comfort foods that are helping you get through?
Absolutely. And I am, I have to give the small business Fran all the due props, Fran Bigelow, because
Fran Fox
sauce is like the best.
What's your favorite one? Do you have a favorite?
I have the dark chocolate sauce on my ice cream with a little bit of the caramel because I like that contrast. Yeah. So the ice cream sundaes have been a big part of my treat for myself at the end of the day.
Yeah.
And I will admit that having you live this all day, I've got to turn off the news. And for me, my escapism is ridiculous books and TV shows like Killing Eve and mm-hmm. and Nordic Noir and mm-hmm. Mysteries that don't have any bearing to my real life.
Right, it's gonna dive in, just kind of get lost for a spell. Well, finally, Governor Cuomo of New York is very fond of the phrase "We are New York tough." I think it's a great phrase. Is there a phrase or a sentence that for you embodies the spirit of Seattleites, or really more Washingtonians?
So I think Seattle is one of the grittiest can-do towns anywhere. Mm-hmm. We have been through cycles of hard times off and on since this city was founded. We lived through a great fire, we went through the pandemic, we saw the Boeing downturn, but we're a city that knows how to come together and to get back at it. And so I think that it's just this gritty sense of connectedness. Mm-hmm. We're a strong community and we will continue being strong. And I really believe that. I think it's at the individual level, but it's the collective level. We're mm-hmm. proud of who we are.
Yeah.
We're proud that we're independent and we're proud that we question authority, but we also are the city that doesn't jaywalk and stops at the don't cross light at 2 a.m.
So true. That's so true. Well, Mayor Durkan, thank you so much for talking with me. Keep up the great work. And I look forward to meeting you in person, even if we're both wearing a mask.
Exactly. And I guess if they're New York strong, we're Seattle strong, but we're also Seattle smart.
Right on. I love it. Yeah. Seattle strong, right. Seattle smart. Okay, well, take good care. And thank you so much again.
You too, Nancy. Take care. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.